Hi friends, I'm Romila Lemos, Assistant Professor, Department of Forensic Biology, Institute of Forensic Science, Mumbai. Today's topic of our discussion and learning is all about Forensic Serology, Part 6. We will be studying the following modules today. Module 1, Confirmatory Examination of Blood. Module 2, Details of Confirmatory Examination of Blood. Module 3, Identification of Species. Module 4, Identification of Species, continued. Module 5, Identification of Blood Group. Module 6, Identification of Blood Group, continued. And Module 7, Conclusion. Microcrystal assays apply chemicals to treat blood stains forming crystals of heme molecules. The morphologies of the resulting crystals are distinctive for heme and can be compared with known standard using a microscope. A positive microcrystal assay strongly indicates the presence of blood. However, confirmatory assays are usually not as sensitive as presumptive assays. Additionally, these assays cannot distinguish between human and animal blood. Crystal tests are regarded by many as confirmatory to presumptive tests. These tests involve the non-protein heme group of hemoglobin, the oxygen-carrying protein of erythrocytes, carrying protein of erythrocytes that belongs to a class of compounds called porphyrins. The heme structure contains a hexavalent iron atom. Four of the iron coordination positions are bound by nitrogen atoms within the ring structure and one is bound to a histidine nitrogen in the globin protein. In hemoglobin, the remaining coordination position is normally bound by water or in oxygenated hemoglobin bound by oxygen. In dried blood stains, these last two positions are used in the formation of crystals that serve as the basis for confirming the presence of blood. Hemochromagin crystal assay. Hemochromagins are heme derivatives in which the ferrous iron of the heme forms two bonds with nitrogenous bases. The method for forming hemochromagin crystals was documented in 1864. Since then, various modifications have been reported. The Takayama crystal assay, published in 1912, has been the method preferred by many forensic laboratories. Takayama reagent is prepared with water, saturated glucose solution, and sodium hydroxide and pyridine in a ratio of 2:1:1:1 by volume. The normal procedure is to place a small stain sample under a cover slip and allow the reagent to flow under and saturate the sample. The blood stain treated with pyridine and glucose, that is a reducing sugar capable of reducing ferric ion under alkaline conditions to form crystals of pyridine ferroprotoporphyrin. After a brief heating period, the crystals are viewed microscopically. The test has been effective on aged stains and crusts. Further, the test has given positive results on blood stains that failed to test positively with the Teichmann test. Here we will be learning about the hematin crystal assay. This assay is also known as the Teichmann crystal assay. In 1853, the Teichmann documented a method of forming crystals of blood specimens. When blood specimens are treated with glacial acetic acid and salts and subsequently heated, hematin chloride, that is ferriprotoporphyrin chloride, a prismatic brown-colored crystal is formed. Hematin is a heme derivative. Its iron is in the ferric, that is the Fe3+ state. This hematin assay has a similar sensitivity and specificity as hemochromagin assays. The hematin assay has the advantage of being more reliable than hemochromatin assays for aged blood samples. The greatest difficulty in performing the test is controlling the heating of the sample, as it is easy to overheat or underheat the preparation, resulting in failure of crystals to form even when blood is known to be present. Apart from the Teichmann and the Takayama crystal assay, additional techniques may be used to confirm the presence of hemoglobin. For example, chromatographic and electrophoretic methods can identify hemoglobin by the mobility characteristics. Spectrophotometric methods for identifying hemoglobin are based on measurements of the characteristic light spectra with peak absorbance at 400 to 425 nanometers absorbed by hemoglobin and its derivatives. Finally, immunological methods utilize anti-human hemoglobin antibodies. This antibody can be used to detect human hemoglobin and thus indicate the presence of human blood. Recently, RNA-based assays have been developed to identify blood. These assays are based on the fact that certain genes are specifically expressed in certain cell types. Thus, the techniques used in the identification of blood are based on the detection of specific types of messenger RNA or mRNA that are expressed exclusively in erythrocytes. These assays utilize reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction or RT-PCR method to detect the gene expression levels of mRNAs for blood identification. Compared with conventional assays that are used for blood identification, the RNA-based assays have higher specificity and are amenable to automation. However, one limitation is that RNA is unstable due to degradation by endogenous and environmentally born ribonucleases. If a stain is identified as blood, the evidence can be tested to determine whether the blood is of human origin or not. If the blood stain is non-human, further analysis is usually not necessary. Before forensic DNA techniques were implemented, species identification was largely determined by serological methods. Nevertheless, species identification assays can be useful for screening to exclude or eliminate non-human samples unrelated to an investigation. Additionally, species identification kits such as immunochromatographic devices allow field testing by crime scene investigators. In cases involving the killing, trading and possession of products derived from species that are protected from illegal hunting, it may be necessary to identify the animal species prior to further analysis. Species identification using DNA analysis can be performed using commonly used loci at the mitochondrial cytochrome B gene, that is CYTB, the cytochrome C oxidase 1 gene, that is COI, and the D loop region. Most assays for species identification are based on the serological techniques including primary and secondary binding assays. The most common primary binding assays are immunochromatographic assay. The most commonly used secondary binding assays are precipitation-based assays that rely on the binding of an antigen to an antibody, causing the formation of a visible precipitation reaction. These precipitation-based assays include ring assays, octoloni assays, and crossed over immunoelectrophoresis. These assays utilize anti-human and anti-animal antibodies to identify human and animal species respectively. For these assays, anti-human antibodies such as anti-human albumin antibodies, anti-human hemoglobin antibodies, anti-human glycoforin A antibodies are produced and made commercially available. Samples can be prepared by cutting out a portion of a stain or scraping stains from a surface. A sample is usually extracted with a small volume of saline or buffer. The extracted sample can be then tested using the above assays. Controls should be included, for example, by using a known human serum as a positive control and an extraction blank as a negative control. Let us begin with double immunodiffusion assays. Ring assay. In this double immunodiffusion assay, an anti-human antibody reagent is placed at the bottom of a test tube and a blood stain extract is placed on top of the bottom layer. The procedure is as follows. For sample preparation and extraction, extract a portion of a stain with saline at 4 degrees Celsius overnight. The controls will include a positive control, that is known human serum sample, and a negative control, that is the extraction blank. For loading the antibody and samples, spin the anti-human antibody in a microfuge and transfer the supernatant into test tubes or capillary tubes depending on the volume of the stain and the anti-serum extracted. The sample is then carefully placed over the top of the anti-serum solution, which is usually denser than the sample. For the immunodiffusion reaction, the reaction is to be carried out at room temperature. In a positive reaction, white precipitate between the two layers can be observed after several minutes. This indicates that the sample is of human origin. No precipitate is formed if a bloodstain extract is from a non-human origin. In a positive reaction, white precipitate between the two layers observed after several minutes indicates that a sample is of human origin. If the bloodstain extract is not human, no precipitation should appear. On occasion, more than one precipitant band will appear, indicating different reacting components with different diffusion coefficients. A standard operating procedure would be to include necessary positive and negative controls with a question sample. The second type is the Ottolony assay. In this assay, the sample preparation and extraction is carried out as follows. Cut out a small portion, that is approximately 5 × 5 mm, of a stain or a portion of a swab. Extract at room temperature in 100 microliters of water for 30 minutes. The extract can then be diluted if necessary. Alternatively, a very small piece of the stain or swab can be inserted directly into the well. The controls are positive control, which is the known serum, a negative control, which is the extraction blank, the substrate controls, that is the extraction of substrate from unstained area wherever necessary. For the agarose gel preparation, a suspension of agarose 4% is heated until liquefied. The solution is then cooled in water bath at 55 degrees Celsius. The agarose is poured onto a piece of glass slide and the gel solidified to a thickness of about 2 to 3 mm. The wells are punched consisting of a central well surrounded by 4 wells using a template. In a positive reaction, a line of precipitate will form between each antigen well and antibody well. This assay can also determine the similarity of the antigens. During the diffusion process, different antigen-antibody complexes migrate at different rates. Consequently, a separate line of precipitate will appear in the gel for each antigen-antibody complex. In an assay in which Two antigens are loaded in adjacent wells and an antibody in the third well, the following results can be observed. If the two antigens are identical, the two lines will become fused. This phenomenon is referred to as identity. If the two antigens are totally unrelated, the lines will cross each other but not fuse. This is known as non-identity. If the two antigens are related, that is, they share a common epitope but are not identical, the lines will merge with a spur formation. The spurs are continuations of the line formed by the antigen due to its unique epitope. This phenomenon is known as partial identity. Thus, in a species test, a positive result is noted when the precipitate lines for the positive controls and the samples fuse. No spur formation should be observed. Incubation at cooler temperatures is a slower process but has the advantage of producing sharper lines and sometimes additional precipitin lines due to the reduced solubility at lower temperatures. Apart from the above techniques, immunochromatographic assays may also be used. Blood groups are defined as antigen polymorphisms present on erythrocyte surfaces. Human erythrocyte surface membranes contain a variety of blood group antigens. Transfusion reactions occur when an incompatible type of blood is transfused into an individual, which can lead to severe symptoms or even death. Karl Landsteiner discovered the first blood group known as the ABO system in the early 1900s while studying transfusion and transplantation. The discovery made blood transfusions feasible and Landsteiner was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1930 for the same. The International Society of Blood Transfusion currently recognizes 29 blood group systems, which include hundreds of antigen polymorphisms. From the 1950s to the 1970s, the structure and the biosynthesis pathways of many blood group antigens were determined. The genes for most of these blood group systems have been identified as well. The isolation of blood group genes has made it possible to understand the molecular mechanisms of the antigenic characteristics of the blood group systems. The ABO system of antigens in human erythrocytes is the most commonly used blood group system for forensic applications. Forensic laboratories also use others, including the RH, MNS, KEL, Duffy, and KID systems. Let us take a look at the ABO blood group system. In the ABO blood group system, two types of antigens, designated as A and B, give rise to four blood groups. Type A individuals have the A antigen, type B individuals have the B antigen, type AB individuals have both A and B antigens, type O individuals have neither A nor B antigens. The antigens may be found in other bodily fluids as well, such as amniotic fluid, saliva, and semen, as well as many organs, including the kidney, pancreas, liver, and lungs. The biosynthesis of antigens. All individuals generate the O antigen, also known as the H antigen. The O antigen is synthesized by fucosyl transferase, a fucose transferase encoded by the FUT genes, which adds a fucose on the end of a glycolipid in erythrocytes or glycoprotein in the tissues. An additional monosaccharide is then transferred to the O antigen by a transferase encoded by the ABO locus. The specificity of this enzyme determines the ABO blood type. The A allele produces the A transferase, which transfers N-acetyl galactosamine to the O antigen and thus synthesizes the A antigen. The B allele produces the B transferase, which transfers galactose to the O antigen and thus synthesizes the B antigen. The O allele has a mutation, that is a small deletion, which eliminates its transferase activity, and no modification of the O antigen occurs. As a result, the A and B antigens differ in their terminal sugar molecules. Subgroups of blood types A and B have been described. The most important ones are the A1 and A2 antigens amongst these. Let us take a look at the secretors and non-secretor status. In addition to erythrocytes, individuals whose A, B and O antigens can be found in other types of bodily fluids are referred to as secretors. 80% of the Caucasian population are secretors. As described earlier, the O antigen is the substrate for the A and B transferase because the A and the B transferase can only utilize a fucosylated substrate. The O antigen is synthesized by fucosylation of the terminal galactosyl residue catalyzed by the fucosyl transferase, which is encoded by the FUT genes. Chromosome 19 contains two homologous genes, that is FUT1 and FUT2. FUT1 is expressed in tissues of mesodermal origin and is responsible for the synthesis of the O antigen in erythrocytes. FUT2 is expressed in tissues of endodermal origin. It is responsible for the synthesis of the O antigen in secretions. About 20% of the Caucasian individuals, those are called as non-secretors, are homozygous for a nonsense mutation in FUT2 at amino acid position 143, resulting in a truncated protein. Bodily fluids such as the semen of type A or B non-secretors who carry homozygous FUT2 mutations contain no A or B antigens despite containing active A or B transferases. This can be a problem in investigating sexual assault cases when the blood type of the seminal evidence needs to be determined. However, non-secretors have O antigens on erythrocytes synthesized by the FUT1 and thus have A or B antigens in blood. Individuals carrying very rare homozygous FUT1 mutations produce erythrocyte O-deficient phenotypes in which the erythrocytes express no O antigens and thus express neither A nor B antigens, regardless of ABO genotype. Individuals who carry both FUT1 and FUT2 mutations have no antigens, nor A nor B antigens, in their erythrocytes and other bodily fluids and are known as Bombay phenotypes. Inheritance of A and B antigens. A and B alleles are dominant and follow blood group Mendelian inheritance pattern. This enables the use of blood typing for paternity testing. Let us look at the forensic applications of blood group typing. The application and usefulness of blood typing in forensic identification are based on the ability to group individuals into four different types using the ABO blood system, allowing individuals to be identified. Frequency distributions of ABO types observed in American Caucasians indicate that 42% individuals have type A blood group, 8% have type B, type AB accounts for 3% of the population, while type O accounts for 47%. Different human populations may exhibit different frequencies of the four blood types. This can be used for the sake of forensic investigation. For example, If one crime scene blood sample is type B and a suspect has type A, the crime scene sample must have a different origin. However, if both the sample and the suspect are type A, the sample may have come from the same origin or from a different origin that happened to be type A. Unfortunately, the probability that any two randomly chosen individuals have an identical blood type is very high. Multiple blood group systems were therefore utilized to decrease the probability of a coincident match. The A and B antigens are very stable and can be identified in dried blood even after many years. They can also be found in semen and other bodily fluids of secretors. Thus, in sexual assault cases, for example, the ABO type of a semen sample can be examined to identify a perpetrator. By studying the different types of techniques used in blood group typing, the most common assays used in forensic serology involve agglutination and include the lattice crust and absorption elution assays. Let us look at the lattice crust assay. It is an agglutination-based assay that utilizes the A, B and O indicator cells to test the agglutination reaction with its corresponding naturally occurring serum antibodies in a question sample. Type A blood contains naturally occurring anti-B antibodies that agglutinate only with B cells. Likewise, type B blood agglutinates only with A cells. Type O blood agglutinates with both A and B cells. And type AB blood does not agglutinate with any of these cells. The lattice crust assay is a simple and rapid technique. However, one limitation is that the assay is not very sensitive and requires a large quantity of blood. Successful agglutination reactions usually require intact cells. The agglutination assay of forensic samples is therefore difficult to carry out because blood cells lyse when they are dry. Therefore, this method is not reliable for testing old stains. The second method is the absorption elution assay. The absorption elution assay is highly sensitive and can be used for testing dried blood stains. This method indirectly detects the presence of antigens. The antigens are immobilized in a solid phase. At low temperatures, the antigens bind to their corresponding antibodies, that is anti-A antibodies, anti-B antibodies or anti-O lectins. The anti-O lectin is isolated from plants and reacts strongly with the O antigen present in type O blood, but has some cross-reaction with the A antigen. The excess unbound antibodies are then removed by washing, and the bound antibodies are then eluted at higher temperatures. The eluted antibodies can then be identified by agglutination assay using A, B and O indicator cells. The blood stains containing the A antigen can bind to anti-A antibodies. The eluted anti-A antibody can form agglutination with A cells. Likewise, for the type B blood, the eluted anti-B antibody can form agglutination with B cells. For type AB, the eluted antibodies can form agglutination with both A and B cells. And with type O blood, the eluted anti-O lectins can form agglutination with O cells. Blood evidence can be of immense evidentiary value in a wide range of crime scenarios. As such, it is necessary to establish a proper standard routine to to enable appropriate analysis of the samples obtained. Confirmatory assays coupled with species identification help identify the presence of human blood at the crime scene. This thus allows the further processing of blood as evidence. The next step is the individualization of the sample. Although DNA profiling is a much more specific, sensitive, and accurate means of determining the identity of a sample, ABO typing can, at a preliminary level, provide for the exclusion of a sample and is therefore still employed in a few laboratories and is known to be quite reliable. Thus, proper analysis of blood stains plays a very important and significant role in crime scene investigation. I will again meet you in another session with more learning lectures in coming episodes. So till then, keep learning. Thank you.